completely absorbed in the John Lennon thing, and he keeps asking me questions about what would John have done and how would he have sung things and how would he have looked and how would he have moved. So he's kind of pushed it right through, which is it's quite impressive to sustain that for all these weeks. The camera stops rolling and his accent continues and his kind of interest in playing the instrument continues, and he tends not to break that. And the further we've gone through this, the more sort of focused he's been on staying in that place. The fact that this is the last day of filming and it's the first gig you see in the film, the whole band are really smooth now, so we're actually having to get them to unsmooth themselves.
There are many key scenes in the film, but, you know, for me, that big revelation scene is, I suppose, the hinge of the film, the final hinge of the film. It signals the last act of the film, and it's crucial, really. It's crucial in John's history.
Oh, yeah, that was tough. I mean, because throughout the film, there was always this feeling that secrets were abound and never actually told. So the climax of the film all had to be about suddenly this information being given, not only to the audience, but how do you do it without and keeping it filmic as well.
We've got a gatecrasher.
I need to talk to John.
Oh, more talking. Wow. You see, me and Mum have had a bit of a heart-to-heart. Yeah, she told me things about, what's his name? Alf. Oh, and about you, funnily enough. Yeah, she said you stole me. What do you reckon, Mimi? Did you?
I never said that.
You said, quote, she, as in you, Mimi, never gave you back. Now, when I don't give things back, I've got to admit, I'm usually stealing.
Seamus and I were quite rigorous. We sat down for a good couple of weeks and storyboarded, and then, you know, with Alice, went through absolutely how it needed to work physically for us to be able to manoeuvre through it. And also, I mean, really, it was sort of set up because that was Mimi's character, and for the whole of that sort of heated passion to take place in her quite cool environment. So a lot of that was established months in advance. And really then it was choreography. I mean, it really was almost like choreographing a dance to make that triangulation work in such a small space as well. And sort of to rehearse it as much as we could without also losing the energy of it.
What on earth have you been telling him, Julia? Did she say why I stole you?
Well, there she is. Ask yourself.
Mimi. Did she mention having another man's child to deal with, another daughter?
Mimi, please.
Please what? Stop? Look at him! Do you think we can stop now?
But at moments when, you know, there's sort of tears and snot and everything, and anger. So, you know, quite terrifying to step into that room and say, OK, can we try that again?
When your father came home after the war, he wanted to try and save the marriage. But she'd have none of it. She told him to get lost. But Alf wasn't giving up that easily, was he, Julia? Hmm? Oh, feel free to join the conversation.
I was keen to do something quite extreme because there were quite emotional flashbacks and showing John in distress almost, sort of his abandonment. We're trying to evoke the period and the sense of memory, not necessarily nostalgia, but certainly the distant memory. The whole kind of quality of the image is altered. So smearing bits of Vaseline on the lens, you know, to further diffuse it.
John?
And I'm also using, in this flashback mode, a filter, which is called the Harrison. This is the number one George filter. And it has a nice effect. I mean, it's quite hideous diffusion, but you can sort of see the difference before and after, you know, when you use it.
And roll, please.
And action.
As the script requires there to be a shabby boarding house with a cafe opposite. There it is. That Mimi can sit in, see the action playing out over the street, rush out and intervene. And trying to find that location a block from the sea with Blackpool Tower in the background, that's the tricky thing.
It's a period film, so you have to go through all the kind of logistics of kind of blocking off the roads, making sure you've got your period vehicles in, getting rid of all the signs so art department are there before you. And we basically, you have very limited time, you know, actors' availabilities, all the other factors we have to, you know, take into account.
Just after the war, so, you know, this is why everything's so boarded up and it's much more down. And this would have hardly been open. It's been shut up for 6 years at least, so, yeah. So this is our sort of brief encounter moment with Mimi on her own, sort of poignantly sitting in a sort of rather charming, faded old cafe. This is a very dark moment. Although red is quite a strong colour inside, we're using a very dark, dark red for the interior of this house because it's John's dream. Kind of like he's in the womb of, because it's his going back in his memory to when he actually split from his mother.
And roll video. And action.
Because in this scene, it's the young boy who's made the choice, you know, to stay inside. He makes the choice to stay with his father and sees his mother walk away and leave him and then runs after her to get her back.
Alf wouldn't let me in the house, said it was between him and your mother. He pleaded with her to give the marriage another chance, to keep the family together. But again, it was of no use. But what to do with you? So in all their great wisdom...
Who do you want to be with, John? Do you want to be with me? Or do you want to be with your mum?
They decided to ask you, a five-year-old boy, who you wanted to spend the rest of your life with. And you said...
Daddy.
Julia, at this point, is in such a fragile state of mind. And so emotional, and I think also in a rather kind of catatonic state. Mimi observes her coming out on her own, and then the young boy rushes out, and it's how these two women are going to interact and react to the young boy coming out, and what Julia would do.
And cut.
Got it?
That's great. From Julia's perspective, it's a scene where she's just had her child taken from her by Alf, her husband, and in the moment where she's let that go, he's then taken away again from her by Mimi.
Camera, speed!
Mimi sees her mental state and sort of scoops him and takes him.
Very occasionally you get to film a film in order, in scene order. Very, very, very rarely. So for me it was actually a wee bit helpful because I was doing all the history, you know? All the things that I'd read up on was actually being realised, and that was really useful.
She was a big sister who disapproved and tried to keep her on the right tracks, and she couldn't bear all this uncertainty with this little boy, I think. She felt that was very unfair. Anne-Marie and I rehearsed it, I think, three times and cried it all three times. and then, yeah, even just watching it, it's choking. And that's her performance, which is so intense. Yeah. Ooh. Yeah.
Oh, John, I was never going to leave you.
No, but you all took the fucking out! Down the street!
Yes, I did, but I was ill. I get ill.
No, you left because you were ill.
Just trying to not make it to, like, an Agatha Christie flashback was quite challenging because it can become dangerously close to being a... And she said, blah, blah, and then showing it. And he wouldn't let me in and showing it. And those... it was quite a tricky manoeuvre to make it not feel like that, to make it feel like a memory as opposed to a show-and-tell sequence. But the performances are so strong in it that within the mechanics of it, within it, it took quite some time to work out because obviously everyone's emotion, each of the characters are very emotionally invested in this information coming from Mimi. And it's just, it was a sort of strategic exercise to work out when to cut to who for what bit of information and why.